And I'm now very much very happy to welcome Dustin Hoffmann. He's a lawyer and he is the office manager for Martin Sonneborn, the party member of the European Parliament. And Dustin Hoffmann had a special insight because he was present on site in the court case against Julian Assange, and he will now tell us about that. In February and September 2020, for 5 weeks altogether, the extradition case was held in court, and we have the closing reports now. And on the 4th of January, the judge said the decision will be announced, and we are very interested what's going to happen there, and happy to start the talk about the extradition case of Julian Assange.
Hallo, vielen Dank für die freundliche Einleitung.
Okay, the stream stopped again.
Hier sein zu können, dieses Mal digital.
Okay, I'm reporting from London digitally.
Es wurde ja gerade schon angekündigt, dass ich
die Möglichkeit, you've already said that I was able to see both parts of the court case personally.
Und ich möchte euch jetzt mal and I'll now take you into meine Erfahrungen aus
the amount of experience, the cache of experience that I have collected. So I'll tell you what I'll be talking about so that you can decide whether you want to stay on. I'll talk to you about who I am. And for those that are not so much familiar with the case, I will give some background. And I would like to explain to you why I actually observed the case, how I came to do that, where the procedures were held, when it was held, who was involved, and the most important block will be about the arguments that were exchanged and how it will continue, although it has been spoiled in a sense.
Wie schon gesagt wurde, mein Name ist Dustin Hoffmann, ich bin der Büroleiter von Martin Sonneborn im Europäischen Parlament.
I am Dustin Hoffmann, I'm the head of the parliamentary office.
Auf Twitter
I followed this case on Twitter. There will be no time for a Q&A, but sometime tomorrow there will be a talk
Geschäftsführer von Reporter
with Christian Nier, a reporter on the case. So if there are any questions there, tomorrow will be a good opportunity for that.
Auf Twitter.
So, very shortly, the background. What happened? Why did the United States apparently developed such a huge problem with Julian Assange and with WikiLeaks? Julian Assange, since 2006, works for the platform WikiLeaks, where whistleblowers can show up and publish material. And in early 2010, Chelsea Manning, who was serving as a soldier in Iraq for the U.S. Army, leaked, took material from computers about the Afghanistan war and the Iraq war and cable reports, which made the case known as Cablegate. This is information that embassies collect and send home so that the government at home is informed what they are doing and what happens.
And
this was given to WikiLeaks by Chelsea Manning and published in stages. This started in July 2010 with the Afghan War Diary that was about the Afghanistan war. And then it continued in October with the Iraq war logs. And from November 2010, the cable reports were published. And what's important here is that from November 2010, it's not as if they just made all the material available in one go. They were redacted, so the timeline of the case is very important, and I'll come back to it. From September 2011, the cable reports were published without redaction. And The fact that these two stages occurred are important for judging the case later on. I'll come back to that when I explain how things went on in front of the court. Now today, Julian Assange is in the Belmarsh prison in London.
Was ist vorher passiert? Wie ist er
How did this happen? How did he get there?
Hat die schwedische Staatsanwaltschaft
in August 2010, the Swedish state prosecutor issued an arrest warrant charging him with sexual misconduct against two women, and on the basis of that, he was arrested in London in December 2010, but released on bail. And the audio has stopped for me.
Auch ein ganz üblicher absolut überwiegende Mehrheit. Allerdings hat er,
weil Because er Angst Assange hat, was afraid of being extradited to the US, after the UK agreed to extradite him to Sweden, Assange escaped into the Embassy of Ecuador. And Ecuador granted asylum, and he was then stuck in the embassy, kind of imprisoned. And he lived there until in April 2019, the asylum was taken away. There was a change of government in Ecuador, a different political direction. They wanted to strengthen ties with the US. And it looks like probably the US exerted pressure on Ecuador, and the British police was then invited in April 2019 to enter the embassy and arrest he was and Assange was arrested because he had skipped bail. And 1 hour after the arrest, the US went ahead and said they want Assange to be extradited, and you might wonder how that happened within this in the space of 1 hour. And the reason was that since 2017 an extradition request had been there, but that had been kept secret. He was pronounced guilty in terms of having skipped bail on the day of the arrest, and sentenced to 50 weeks in prison. And now the audio has stopped again.
Eigentlich insbesondere weil die der zurückgezogen ist und diesmal erledigt halt wirklich die Funktionsauflagen und dafür
so he went to prison and he is now imprisoned in Belmarsh prison under very difficult circumstances
nur noch wegen der also diese
and
mit den Funktionsauflagen ist durch keiner Sache schuldig gesprochen oder so er sitzt jetzt nur
he's in extradition imprisonment now, the skipping bail issue has been dealt with and is over, but because he is said to be liable to try to escape, he removed his electronic, oh dear, this is not going to go well.
So the
US in May 2019 stepped up the charges and based them on an espionage law from
1917. Das ist im Großen und Ganzen wahrscheinlich einfach gewesen, um die
And that was probably simply to exert more pressure on the defense. Because they were given very little time to prepare the defense. How did I get to observe the proceedings?
Wir hatten bei uns im Büro
we were debating in the Martin Sonneborn office. And I wanted to speak about Julian Assange. I don't know if that was in Parliament. I didn't get that because the audio is breaking up again.
War mir die ganze Sache auch ein bisschen.
Okay.
I've just heard from the control room that my audio is breaking up, so For bandwidth reasons, I'm going to switch off my camera. And I hope that that will improve things. Well, doesn't seem to be the case. Is there any guidance from the control room? I'm very sorry. Can the control room tell me which parts were lost? I'll just continue.
Ich mache einfach weiter.
So in April 2019,
hat mein Chef gesagt,
superior Martin Sonneborn, MEP, said I should be speaking about Julian Assange. I wasn't so sure. I remember there was something, sexual misconduct, rape charges, and he said, well, take a deeper look. And there was the UN Special Rapporteur issuing a report that I looked at, and I read that and thought, what the hell is this? What is happening? And I then read more into the, it, and when the procedure started in February, there were NGOs active in Brussels asking for political observers, saying that, well, the case is now starting, it would be good if people were there to keep an eye on what is happening and observe and report about it. And when the pandemic started, we decided that we should ask whether I, the office manager, could go in his place, in Martin Sonneborn's place, and for reasons of health protection, I am younger. So we decided that I would be the one to go and observe the case in February, as well as in September. I was there to observe in Martin Sonneborn's name and report back to him. As already said, there were these two blocks in February 2020 and in September. There are administrative hearings once a month, which normally take just 5 to 10 minutes. A small anecdote on that later. And on the 4th of January, the decision is supposed to be announced, and said that there were many observers in February and not so many very restrictive actors in September. So two German MPs from the left party were there, lots of press. That was all accepted, and in September suddenly things were very different. It was quite easy for me. I wrote an email and heard, okay, we'll tell the court and you can come. But when we arrived, there was quite an outcry because NGOs around the world were trying to observe, and Reporters Without Borders were trying it and were not given access. They were given seats in the room. And we tried to find out why. We tried to exert pressure on the first day. They said, you can go to the visitors gallery, but overall, it always was a problem. On the first day of proceedings, the video links, there were streams that were generated that political observers and the press could use, and NGOs as well. And these access points for political observers and NGOs were all withdrawn on the first day, so they were there and had no access at all to the proceedings. And in that regard, I talked to Christian Mier from Reporters Without Borders. He is the executive of the German department, and he is very experienced with observing court cases around the world. And when journalists are indicted, Reporters Without Borders go and observe what's going on. I had an interview with him and asked him how he compares this to other cases, and this is a quote from the video. I have to say at first that I felt more welcome in all these countries, Turkey and Russia, as an observer from an international human rights organization, Reporters Without Borders, that has observer status at the United Nations, at the European Council and other international institutions, more welcome than here at this extradition procedure against Julian Assange. Now, that
ein ziemlich bitteres Bild. Und im Endeffekt lief das so ab, dass die wenigen Plätze, die es gab,
activists in the morning queued from very early on and then handed over their seats to the NGOs, saying that Reporters Without Borders should be there. Without these activists who got up early and queued, even fewer people would have had an opportunity to let NGOs watch.
Es gab
there were two locations where the court case was carried out, in the Woolwich Crown Court and the Central Criminal Court, Old Bailey in London. Why was that? The first court is very far outside London, because it is right next to the prison Julian Assange is being held in. And there is a tunnel from the court from the prison right into the court.
Sollte die Sache logistisch leichter machen und dann muss man nicht so viel hin und her gefahren
sein. So he wouldn't be, it wouldn't have to be transferred from one location to the other.
Vor dem Rüberführen, nach dem Rüberführen durchsucht wurde, seine Zelle mehrfach durchsucht wurde.
Still, his cell was searched several times during the court hearing and his documents were scrutinized, even though they had those added security measures already. So that was bizarre. It's a very depressing building as well.
Bedingungen im Gefängnis.
And you don't hear anything better from the conditions at the prison. Supposedly the radiator isn't working and it's very cold in the building. The canteen, I can report from there for myself, was less than perfect.
And
if that is what the lawyers are eating, I don't want to know what the prisoners are getting. The other court is Old Bailey in London, which is a famous court. You can compare it to the highest court in Germany. But the biggest difference to the German edition is that it is way older and it goes back to times of where the death penalty was still frequently carried out and
hingerichtet wurden.
In olden times, executions were carried out in front of the court. And if you've seen V for Vendetta, you may remember the building for the one that was blown up in the end. And it's been reconstructed and renovated. And on top of the dome, you can see Justice.
Die eigentliche Verhandlung fand in einem Nachbargebäude, in einem Neubau statt, der nicht ganz so.
The actual process was in a different part of the building that's less ancient. Who was part of the proceedings? Of course, Julian Assange himself, who sat at the far end of the room behind a thick glass barrier. Across from him, the judge, Vanessa Baritza.
Damit ihr irgendwie ein bisschen einordnen könnt, wie es kommt.
Just for context, the buildings and rooms of the court are not relevant to the proceedings, because
ein Verfahren des
it's a magistrate court proceedings with a district judge.
Diese Gerichte machen normal, diese Richterinnen machen
normally this court
Verfahren
would carry out small proceedings with less than a year prison terms.
System beruhen, dass Staaten gegenseitig
but
sich in ihre
states trust in
und
each other's rule of law.
Und
and
meistens, also so ein if Land klagt
a state
an, der in einem anderen Land ist, also, und sagt dann halt, ja,
is prosecuting
machen,
a person in another state,
dann
man,
ja,
then
ja
because the states are friends,
nicht so oft, so
the
Das ist in der Sache natürlich jetzt
court cases krass, can be carried out in the other country, and here we had a district court judge, which says nothing about her competence, but still it's a very large task. Then we have the legal teams on the prosecution and the defense side. In defense, Edward Fitzgerald, Mark Summers and Florence Iveson. Just to tell you how these proceedings go on, we have different kinds of lawyers, we have barristers,
alle möglichen
and they have tasks like
also klassische Anwaltsarbeit und die Barristers
no, barristers stehen nur in only in the court
und fragen davor, also es sind quasi so wirklich die Leute.
Now the audio is gone, unfortunately.
Dieses QC steht für Queen's Counsel, das ist ein Titel, der wird verliehen für besonders erfahrene Leute, also wir haben hier zwei besonders hochrangige erfahrene Anwälte auf Seiten der Verteidigung. Ich habe damals ein bisschen recherchiert.
I did some research on the barristers. Edward Fitzgerald is
zusätzlich, also sind wirklich sehr gute Leute.
A very renowned lawyer. Sitzen noch weitere and Leute, also the other lawyers.
Die ihr vielleicht kennt.
Are
Foto.
Very good lawyers.
Jennifer Robinson sitzt mit im Saal.
Stella you have Morris, Stella Morris von, here, Julian's fiance and other WikiLeaks members, Joseph Farrell, the WikiLeaks ambassador, and also Julian Assange's father.
Die prosecution der US-Regierung
was carried out by Lewis Dobbin and Smith.
Und Zeugen haben wir
there were also testimonies,
zugeschaltet, viele auch aus den
but
USA.
They were done digitally
das hat das Verfahren häufig sehr
and zögert, with great delay because of technical problems.
Probleme gab. Die Leute konnten sich nicht verbinden, die Verbindung ist abgebrochen.
So,
also sind wir hier nicht allein. Gerade schon mal ein bisschen angedeutet, wer mit dem
Saal ist. Also, da ist die
Verhandlung sitzt und es gab einen zweiten Saal.
Main Hall, and then there's a different hall, where the.
Saßen, die Leute von der Presse.
Where there's a stream.
Das führte dazu, zu dem absurden Umstand,
so people from the press
dass,
could watch.
Julian Assange but because in diesem,
Julian Assange is behind the glass, he doesn't have a micro. He didn't have a microphone,
und
and
das führt dazu,
because
wenn
he wasn't supposed to be talking.
Was er gesagt hat.
And press couldn't understand him at all.
Die Leute mit der Gerichtsverwaltung
so,
ausgehandelt haben, dass immer jemand von der Presse mit im Saal sitzt.
Agreed on that somebody could always be in the hall, so they could write down what Julian Assange said and then tell the others.
Damit die Leute
so that
zitieren können.
People would be able to cite him.
Schon.
Now,
jetzt
let's
nochmal um das
talk
Stock, ich jetzt schon
about the proceedings, gesagt, part one of the proceedings in February, that was 4 days, where just papers were being read. Both sides presented their case. Now the audio is gone again.
Das haben wir um das Stock genannt.
It's strictly prohibited to take photos in court, so I didn't take this photo, but I found it on Twitter, and I wanted to show you, because that it is what it looked like the first part of the trial. You can see Assange behind the bars with behind the glass with a security member, and the acoustics was incredibly bad.
Pressevertreter, weil der Raum
the press members were basically crammed into a tiny building container. And if somebody spoke into the mic, as soon as they would start speaking, you couldn't understand anything anymore. So it was basically impossible to understand what was being said. And the acoustics in the room itself was also so bad that the lawyers asked whether Julian Assange could talk to them directly. because anytime he wanted something, people would have to turn back.
And
even the prosecution said that would be okay because it's not about a violent crime. And the judge
said, selten traute Einheit. Man sagte die Richterin, ja,
yeah, well, no, it's difficult because if he's not in the dock,
dann,
and the audio is gone. So no, they didn't do it. They delayed it. They postponed it to the next day. And it came out that it's not true. You don't have to get special permission to for the lawyers to talk to Assange directly, but still the judge prohibited it.
Und wenn er halt was will, dann müssen wir das Verfahren halt unterbrechen. Das ist hier egal, dann dauert es halt länger.
And they said, well, we have time. The proceedings will go on as long as they need. And unsurprisingly, the second court hearing, they didn't suddenly didn't have time. So when somebody wanted to talk to the judge, he wanted to say something to his team, and then up on the visitor gallery, people started waving for attention that the lawyer wanted to talk, and then other people just kept talking over that person. Patchy audio, sorry. So this just shows how impractical the whole court hearing was, but the judge was still of the opinion that that was fine. And that's not understandable because all visitors I've spoken to didn't understand at all why that was the case and why he couldn't sit with his lawyers. So coming to the part two of the proceedings in September,
und da geht es um die
about the content and the cases.
Warum Julian Assange nicht
so prosecution had to kind of justify why they would extradite Assange.
In dem stehen bestimmte Gründe drin, warum jemand nicht ausgeliefert
wird. So, for example, there are different justifications for why people can't be extradited.
Es könnten dann auch aus anderen Gründen
because of
unmenschliche
unfair treatment in US courts.
Das Verfahren
Patchy audio, sorry.
Habe ich jetzt mal angeführt, die um deutlich zu machen. Aus dem Gegenstand. Das ist nicht eine Schuss. Das ist nicht Bestandteil dieser Sache, aber wir haben auch
eine. But we have also heard die technical experts.
Wie funktioniert eigentlich
that,
wie wird ein Passwort in Windows generiert und gespeichert?
Testified about how passwords are generated and saved and what kinds of encryption is unbreakable.
Das hat jetzt allerdings für die,
but that was for context, so that we got an understanding of the technical possibilities and the technical background. I must admit that I still don't understand everything.
Hatte. Es lag nicht am
and that was not because of the witnesses, that's because of me. It would have been more understandable for others, I guess.
Jetzt kommt ein Zeuge.
Now,
wie läuft es ab?
Also ich when von Zeugen, I speak about witnesses, it may be a bit confusing because there are different types of witnesses in English, and there are also expert witnesses who just provide technical background and not just witnesses who have witnessed the actual event.
Deswegen habe ich das nochmal da hiermit aufgenommen.
So,
diese Leute, die da,
witnesses were called by defense and not by the prosecution, and they had their expert opinion in writing.
Hat die Seite
und die Defense
Moment Zeit, um das
nochmal could go through the expert opinion and ask questions to the expert, and then there's the cross examination where the other side is being questioned. That can go on for an hour, maybe even for 4 hours.
Sehr, sehr intensiv. Die Anwälte, die
so,
Anklage sich da angeholt hat.
Die Prosecution definitely had a special way of dealing with the witnesses. I haven't seen many British court cases, so I may not know what's normal, but those are experts. They're really experts on their field. And they try, and prosecution tried to discredit their expertise.
Und eigentlich total pro Julian Assange oder
and
dass
tried to
und das ist manchmal total
well, it was absurd, really absurd because they tried to undermine those experts, even though they were scientists, professors, and the lawyers, they pretended to all like an exam at school, asking them very basic questions for hours.
Wir hatten einen Professor.
We had a neuropsychiatry professor who said that, who even was asked things like, what is the definition of depression? And he said things like, excuse me, I'm actually, I helped define depression. I certainly won't have to do that here. So, yeah.
Aufrufende Seite nochmal klarstellen, wenn Leute aufs Glatteis geführt werden, kann man sagen, sicher, sie meinten sie das nicht so und so und ja, so ergibt sich dann so ein Bild.
So this is how this picture emerges about the whole character of the case.
Gehen wir in die,
now,
in die mögliche
about the possible political motivation of the procedure of the court case. One of the main items that we talked about a lot was Trump's war on journalism.
War on journalism.
That is a thing that
Punkt,
you probably have all heard already. We heard about people analyzing how often Trump on Twitter was attacking journalists. There was a professor on journalism, Mark Feldstein, who quite early Leon,
der hat dann einfach mal eine, der hat eine Geschichte ausgeholt, bei der er gesagt hat, dass
Feldstein, when Donald Trump was elected,
ein paar Monate
Audio racking up again
offen hat und gesagt hat, dass es irgendwie
and den ganzen Leak so it was said that the whole thing with all these leaks and whistleblowers is just not on
gesagt, ja,
and
wir sollten,
the response was
that
we should be putting a head on the spike as a message.
We should. Und Trump damals soll darauf geantwortet haben, ja,
Trump sollten wir Journalisten supposed, maybe said, apparently said that maybe we should put some journalists
hat er dann
in prison.
General, and then angewiesen,
he instructed his director general to
kriminelle Leaks gegen Fake
take
Teams,
action against leaks,
Haus,
that, anything that was leaked that was embarrassing to the White House. And
so Moment,
that was
das,
a moment when
ganz
it really started.
Also ich glaube, dass das
it was interesting from a scientific point of view to listen to observe this, as we've all seen that Donald Trump as a president had a different way of dealing with the press than his predecessors. But it was interesting to actually have empirical proof on that. Of course, the opposing side doesn't agree at all and says that Trump does not have any specific issues with the press. But just to make clear where all this anger might come from, the whole whistleblower thing, the whole aggression against WikiLeaks, we've heard many witnesses say how important the work done by WikiLeaks is for investigative journalism and for uncovering state misbehavior. We heard a professor saying that the way war is conducted has changed because states are not simply entering into military exchanges, because it's no longer possible to deceive the public about the way things are going. We had representatives of the Iraq Body Count Project saying that through the Iraq war leaks, the number of civil casualties was corrected up by 15,000. 15,000 civil deaths that no one knew about before could now be added to the death toll and from the materials that were published. And that, of course, is unpleasant to the warring parties and to the warring war coalition, and that's why they're not fans of WikiLeaks. And we were going to hear Khaled Al-Masri, Khaled Al-Masri, a German citizen, as a witness. Audio breaking up.
Aus dem Doktor reingerufen, was zuversiert wird,
weil Khaled Al-Masri is a victim of US torture, and it would have been one of the rare moments when an actually proven torture victim could have confronted the US lawyers, but that did not happen. The only way to actually say something was to shout things from the gallery we heard earlier. Breaking up again.
Schmerzveröffentlichung von Unterlagen.
So we can see how painful the publication of materials from WikiLeaks can be. Khaled Al-Masri is a German national with Lebanese background, lived in Germany for 25 years, and late 2003, audio gone again. Without any reason, he was held for 3 weeks. He was not allowed to contact the German embassy because it was not believed that his passport was genuine. He wasn't allowed to contact a lawyer. And at that point already, he was being tortured as the United Nations Court on Human Rights has found. He was driven to the airport, and men in masks were waiting for him, cut off his clothing. He was given,
fand sich in einem Flugzeug wieder, wurde verschleppt, und dann, wie später herausgefunden hat, tauchte im Afghanistan auf.
On a retention flight and turned up in a torture prison,
fortlaufend befragt, gefoltert,
in Afghanistan.
Und das war eine Verwechslung. Also, sie haben das,
and it turned out they had got the wrong person.
Und ist irgendwann in Hungerstreik getreten für
34 Tage. And he went on a hunger strike.
Wussten die schon, dass es der
Well, they were still, well, they were already aware that he was the wrong guy. But they kept on holding him, torturing him, although they knew he was the wrong person.
And mit einer Nasensonde zwangsernährt.
For 34 days,
an sich, also jemanden mit einer Nasensonde
force-fed him.
Ich sage extra Nasensonde, weil Sonnenernährung
through the nose. And that is incredibly painful.
Und ja, hat auch da mit einem deutschen Muttersprachler
and he talked with a native German speaker called Sam.
Woher der kam, welche
it's not clear what role that person had.
Jedenfalls
when Khaled Al-Masri was then released
ihm wurde gesagt,
and told that he would never be allowed to talk about what had happened to him. They would keep him,
darüber reden würde, würden schon Sachen passieren.
Keep watching him and something would happen. He was then put on another flight.
Mit Kopfdeckung, also konnte nicht
his head was covered.
Gemeint, dass er in einem Land war, wo die Leute, die
all he knew was that he was in a country where people were speaking a Slavic language. He was released and put on a street and told not to turn around but just walk down the street, and he assumed that that would be his death. They would be shooting him from behind. That did not happen. He went around a corner, there were three policemen, and found out that he was in Albania and then flown to Germany. He went home, his wife went to Lebanon, he had gone to Lebanon, and the wife, having noticed that the husband had disappeared, had gone back to Lebanon, his children were gone, so he took on a lawyer, and no one believed him at first. In Germany and the US, with the help of investigative journalists, he tried to achieve justice. There was a court case against 13 CIA employees. Nothing at all happened in the US. So they thought, okay, this is just collateral damage of what we have to do. And
das Krasse war, wo
the incredible thing is, and this is where WikiLeaks is very important, through the diplomatic cables that were published, it turned out that the German government, at least when he had been returned to Germany, they knew about what happened, and they knew that had been a mistake in identity, but nobody helped him. He was still fighting for people to believe him, and the German government already knew. It later turned out that the US government, it was clear from the materials that the US government had exerted pressure on the German government to not seek extradition of these CIA agents. And that, of course, for a government is a very painful thing to do, if that would become known that even their own citizens were being left unprotected.
Wir haben als schriftliches Statement noch bekommen von Dean Yates, der damals in 2007 der Leiter der Reuters
was the head of the Reuters dependency in Bagdad. Das,
Reuters ist
Reuters
eine Nachrichtenagentur,
is a press agency, and he was there
da,
when
war,
the incident that you may know as collateral murder,
das
which is one of the videos.
Ganz kurz ab, da ist
an incident when a US Apache fighter helicopter shot civilian people and two Reuters journalists as well.
Und hat halt ausgesagt, dass damals nach diesem Zwischenfall
Dean Yates said that after this incident he had contact with the military that showed him extracts from the video and said, well, we thought through the camera we thought was a weapon and an anti-tank weapon, and there was nothing we could do. He always tried to receive the full video, never did. And then it was published as collateral murder by WikiLeaks, and then he saw that the whole claims were wrong. The video is very hard to watch. These pilots are congratulating themselves, each other. They are mocking the dead people, the victims, and it's quite clear from the video that
the
way it was claimed is not the way it happened, and the mistaking of a camera for a weapon is very unlikely. So, he is still suffering from the fact how he was deceived. He suffers from post-traumatic stress disorder, saying that his whole family life was ruined
because
he thought something could have been done, maybe they acted wrong, it's my own fault, and then he found through WikiLeaks that wasn't the case at all. It was just a severe war crime.
Entschuldigung, ich habe eine Sache gerade, ich den jetzt abschließe bei
I forgot to say about Al-Masri. The International Criminal Court has taken on the issue now.
Al-Masri case, Folter in Afghanistan,
the torture in Afghanistan in a US-run prison.
Gegen die Chefanklägerin des internationalen
Strafgerichts. The US has taken action against the chief prosecutor at the International Criminal Court. That's the kind of response you can expect.
Wir haben noch einige weitere.
We heard other investigative journalists that said that material from WikiLeaks was about the most valuable that they had, making it possible to understand things they could never have understood otherwise. And just as a small overview, this shows how important this is for the public and how dangerous for governments if their misconduct should become known. The Afghanistan war, as well as the Iraq war, was portrayed as something that went very well and then where everyone was behaving very well, and it's become known that that was not the case and that the public was quite heavily deceived.
And
in the course of this political process, the timeline is very important too.
Also nach diesem Spionage.
A typo here.
auf diesen Spionage, diese Spionage.
It's very important from the indictment to know that the Obama administration was already investigating, but no charges were brought. And we've heard from several sources that this was because the Obama administration was reticent to establish precedents.
Die ganze Pressefreiheit that would
put the whole press freedom into question. Now, when the Trump administration was in place, suddenly the charges were brought. And to understand the way this was published on other platforms as well, we have to understand how this all happened, how these diplomatic reports were published unredacted by WikiLeaks later on. When they received the material, WikiLeaks contacted several leading Western media and established a working group that took a look at the materials. They were given the materials and went through them. And this would only be published in redacted form, names blacked out, so that no sources would be revealed
and das halt keine Quelle
put in danger,
dass Leute nicht in Gefahr gebracht werden.
And no one else either. And what happened was that WikiLeaks, Julian Assange, handed out an encrypted document, and the encryption, as we heard from a witness, was not breakable without knowing the password within the framework of what is now technically possible. What happened now is that a Guardian journalist, David Lay, wrote a book about the whole affair. And because at the time WikiLeaks was targeted by hackers repeatedly who tried to take down the website, there were several mirrors of that page, and these included this file. Now, this journalist wrote the book in which he described the scene when Assange gave him the password for that file, and Assange gave him one part of the password on a paper, and another part had to be added through something that Assange explained to him orally. And the whole password then was published by this journalist in his book. And it took a while until an article at the Freitag magazine appeared and said, a data leak has occurred. If you put one and one, if you put two and two together, you can decrypt the whole thing. And when this happened, Assange directly contacted the White House saying that this data leak had occurred and something could happen, something could come, please be prepared. But they just fobbed him off and didn't deal with the whole issue. So it took a while. And the complete unredacted materials were then published on cryptome.org. And there, that site is located in the US. It's a leak platform, and from that platform you can still download the whole material. And no one ever from the US government contacted these people to take this material down. And when this was published on Cryptome, WikiLeaks followed suit and published it themselves, but only later. So any political motivation that it could now suspect, why was nothing, no action taken against Cryptome.org and archive.org, the Wayback Machine, still has a copy, and that is still online. They never heard from anyone to take this offline.
So
it's all online, but only WikiLeaks is being pursued as a consequence. So that's just there to give you an overview of the situation about the extradition case.
And also a very important topic and aspect, which is very decisive for the decision, is for a possible non-extradition, where
Sachverständige und
medical experts and medical witnesses. We were not given the written testimonials, and there was not much report on that because it's very personal, and that is why I also don't want to give too many details because it also concerns families and children, which are not important for us here. But it's also about depression
and specific
preparation. So if that topic is difficult or triggering for you, we advise you not to listen to the following part, but I have to mention it. So there was an expert who diagnosed Julian Assange with Asperger's, which is a form of autism.
Bestellt sich die Frage, ob
okay, the audio is patchy again. But we'll come back to autism and Asperger's later because of the conditions in the US. Secondly, he was diagnosed with depression of medium severity, and also the depression is very much dependent on his conditions of imprisonment. When he was in prison, in a prison clinic where he couldn't meet any other people, mental health was very bad. He was suicidal. People said he looked like a ghost. And especially in the US, he's very much afraid of being extradited and of being isolated because of the way he was already treated. The audio is patchy again. So I mentioned one professor already, a professor Copeland from Peace College, neuropsychiatry professor, which I already mentioned, and he wrote an expert opinion where he said that Julian Assange got his hands on a razor blade in order to kill himself. And the prosecution tried to undermine his testimonial by saying, it could have been that you just imagined that because it wasn't mentioned before, and tried to gaslight him and say that wasn't part of the investigation before. And then defense showed this piece of paper where the razor blade was found in a search of the prison cell, so it definitely existed. There's proof of that.
Dass er diese für einen möglichen Suizid
It was clear that he was suicidal.
Von Professor Copeland war besonders intensiv und insbesondere weil die ganze Zeit wieder versucht wurde seine
It was incredible how prosecution tried to undermine the expert and undermine his expert opinion. And the prosecution said,
überhaupt irgendwie vernünftig
that
zwei Tests gemacht,
he didn't do his tests correctly.
T-O-M-M, und da meinte Lewis, ja, aber das ist doch gar nichts, hat doch gar nichts mit Simulieren zu tun. Das ist doch, hat doch mit der Teste gar nichts damit zu tun.
It was questioned whether the tests were inaccurate or whether he was just simulating.
So
the prosecution basically tried anything to get a hold of any point. It was very pointless in the end, but very tiring.
An einem Punkt hat er dann gesagt, ja, Das war übrigens der, der gesagt hat, er sei auch nicht zum Einstufungstest da. Der hat dann gesagt, ja,
so ist ein bisschen eigenartig. Strange. Die ganze Zeit, als ob ich keine Professor said so that gut, the prosecution tried to pretend I was not an expert or worthless as an expert because before that they tried to hire me as an expert.
Ja, die
der Anklage so, yeah, they basically put them in their place, like defense was able to put prosecution in their place.
So schlecht, dass Copelman seinen Statement.
And this is a citation from Copelman. He said, I reiterate again that I'm as certain as a psychiatrist can ever be that in the event of imminent extradition, Mr. Assange would indeed find a way to commit suicide. And we all remember that Assange, if he is in bad mental or physical health, can't be extradited. So I again have to reiterate how important this razor blade is and his mental health is, and whether he's going to be considered as too unstable to be extradited. So, and the razor blade, that is a fact. They can't. Well, coming back to bad treatment in US prisons, I want to introduce two witnesses who spoke. In England, officially, there's no isolation in prison, but there are so-called SAM, special administrative measures. If inmates are suspect of having critical information that could endanger the state, they can be applied. And of course, Julian Assange had many documents that had not yet been published that could endanger the US or could be deemed dangerous to the US.
And
we talked to a former MCC
correctional center in New York gehört. Das Gefängnis kennt ihr vielleicht, da saß
this is a this is the prison where also El Chapo was imprisoned and Jeffrey Epstein as well
before er well, nicht mehr lebte
und he died.
Und
and
sie, die Frau hat,
this woman reported about the SAM measures. They, people are imprisoned for 23 hours isolated. They can't see any other prisoners. Guards don't talk to them. And they have 1 hour of recreation a day where they can run in a circle. That's it. And then they're back to their cell.
Das ist quasi die Nicht-Isolation.
That is the non-isolation.
Und wie sowas konkret ablaufen kann, haben wir
and we also talked to the lawyer of Abu Hamza,
die hat,
who said that
der wurde aus dem, dem
well, he was suspect of being a terrorist and also
in dem Auslieferungsverfahren haben sie
prosecuted gesagt, by the US.
Da ist eigentlich, der kommt bestimmt nicht in Supermax-Gefängnis,
where they
nicht verhängt und das ist alles
claimed that he was not in super prison, not in SAM, but still he was extradited to the US and
nach seiner Verurteilung
in the US he was brought to Supermax prison.
Seine Sams wurden kürzlich wieder
and
erneuert, weil er
he wrote a letter
in dem er geschrieben hat,
to his
Enkel,
son,
dass ich ihn liebe.
Where he das said, tell my grandson that I love him, and that was that was evaluated as illegal contact, and
he got
he got graded up again, and the same happened when he asked for his toenails to be clipped. So we're running out of time, but I would like to mention one more aspect. because of the surveillance of the embassy by UC Global, because Julian Assange lived in that embassy and he was subject to extreme surveillance measures, and we had testimonials of what happened there. David Morales said that they were now in Premier League and there was proof of security cameras being exchanged. Now the audio is back off.
Fuck. Wenn das denn jetzt nicht gleich wieder...
Okay, he's back. Microphones were installed in the bathroom, in the conference room, just about anywhere. And they were recording calls from where he talked with his lawyer with priority, and they took photos of him and his lawyers. They stole fingerprints and they made handwriting analysis, and they even stole diapers in order to get a paternity test. And also, patches were attached to the window that allowed them to intercept conversations. And there were also his office was broken into. And also, they concretely planned to assassinate him. And also, they copied documents from the lawyers. So this is like a criminal novel. It all reads like a crime novel. And all these years, Julian Assange was massively put under surveillance, and that also affected his lawyers. And it was clearly done by the US. So it is very questionable whether this is a fair proceedings.
Das steht zumindest ist stark zu bezweifeln.
Okay. Look at what is ahead of us. Both sides exchanged written statements, and the judge read those over Christmas and will announce the verdict on 4th of January, where I also requested to be present, because I've been the only political observer who was present all the time, but it was decided that no political observers are allowed from now on. So this is where we come back to the beginning, where I said that this is all very strange. But I hope that we'll have access to media streams. The press will have access to media streams. I was repeatedly asked by the press to stop talking. I will now do that. I hope that I could give you a good and neutral overview of the proceedings. There were many protesters in front of the court, and they were calling, there's only one, no extradition, and I can only repeat that, because it would not be a rule of law if that would happen. Thank you. Thank you for your presentation,
Dustin.
Unfortunately, we don't have time for Q&A, but Dustin said that tomorrow he'll be present in a RC3 session. Details will follow on his Twitter account. You can follow him at
DHBLN oder ich buchstabiere Delta Hotel Bravo Lima November ist seine Twitter-Handle DHBLN.
DHBLN. Dort
Dustin folgen,
follow him
und er wird euch rechtzeitig
he will tell you where and when you will have opportunities to ask questions.
Ich glaube, dieser
Session I think there will be many questions after this fascinating presentation and we will get more answers on 4th of January. Thank you, Dustin, for your presentation and we will, our next presentation is on facial recognition. So have a good evening.